Hi, my name is Kate Timms, and today I'm going to be talking to you about Western blots for extracellular vesicle samples. The Western blot is a technique that I and a lot of researchers have a bit of a love-hate relationship with. It's often regarded as some kind of dark magic. In reality, the Western blot is just a technique full of potential pitfalls, especially where EVs are concerned. In this video, we will walk you down that tricky road of Western blots for EV samples, point out these potential pitfalls, and hopefully help you to avoid them. Today, I'll cover controls, lysis, loading strategies, Western blot conditions, evaluating your blot, and what to do if you are still having issues. So let's get started. First, ensure you have the correct controls in place. Now, these could include a raw pre-isolation sample, an EV-enriched sample, and a protein-enriched or EV-depleted sample being tested side by side to tell you whether your protein of interest is likely EV-associated or a free protein. You might also consider using a recombinant version of your protein of interest and or a cell lysate to help identify whether your protein is being detected at the correct size. Make sure to determine your controls up front as you will need to treat them the same way as your samples. Now, onto sample preparation. Whilst it is more common to lyse EVs, some people report not lysing their EVs at all. But if EVs are still intact, it is hard to rationalise how a size-based separation technique like Western blots would work. Cytosolic proteins likely wouldn't be released, and membrane proteins may not travel the correct distance down the gel. So whilst some people appear to get good results using this method, we recommend starting your sample preparation with EV lysis. If you do choose to lyse, you'll need a lysis buffer, typically Reaper. Don't forget to add protease inhibitors to prevent potential sample degradation. Your EVs may contain proteases, but you won't know this until it's too late. For phosphorylation studies, include phosphatase inhibitors. Typically, protease and phosphatase inhibitors are added to the lysis buffer just before use. Now that you've picked a lysis buffer and you have controls ready, let's move on to the lysis procedure itself. Your EV samples are most likely a liquid EV isolate. To achieve a concentration of 1x Reaper in this case, you must treat your sample as the diluent, to which your concentrated Reaper is added to achieve a final concentration of 1x. If you have an EV pellet, perhaps because you've used their QEV magnetic concentration kit, then you can add pre-diluted 1x Reaper straight to the pellet. However, you may not want to just use 1x Reaper. EVs can be tricky to lyse, so Reaper concentrations of 5x or even higher may be required. It is always a good idea to try a range of concentrations and pick the one that works best for your sample. Anecdotally, we've found that plasma-derived EVs are harder to lyse than cell culture EVs, meaning that the origin of your EV sample may play a role in the concentration of lysis buffer that you choose. Once you've optimized your lysis procedure, you will need to know how much of your sample to load. Ideally, you would know this before lysing to ensure that you have enough sample, but this may not be possible in the optimization phase. There are two ways of normalizing the amount of sample added to your Western blot: by volume and by protein amount. If you are comparing between isolated fractions from the same sample, then it is better to use equal volumes of sample rather than an equal amount of protein. This is because different fractions will have different concentrations of EVs, and preserving this difference is important for comparing fractions. In this instance, you would just use the maximum possible volume to ensure the strongest signal. However, if you're comparing between two different samples, then you may choose to load your Western blot gel with an equal amount of protein, as determined by a protein assay. The amount of protein that you need to detect your protein of interest may vary. When starting out, load the maximum possible amount of protein. This is the amount of protein that you are able to load by adding the maximum volume possible of the most dilute sample. The maximum volume will be dictated by the volume of your wells. The final consideration for sample preparation is whether you want to use a reducing or non-reducing loading buffer. Loading buffers are heavy and viscous in nature, allowing your proteins to sink to the bottom of the well. A reducing agent, such as beta-mercaptoethanol, is often added to the loading buffer to help with denaturing your proteins by breaking disulfide bonds. Heating is also used to aid in denaturing proteins. For this, 95 degrees Celsius for 5 minutes is commonly used, though longer incubation times may improve denaturation. Some antibodies work best when your samples have been reduced, whilst others work best when your samples haven't been reduced. Manufacturers will often tell you which to use. This means that your choice of antibody will dictate whether you use reducing conditions. With new antibodies, it can be good to test performance in both reducing and non-reducing conditions, especially if the antibody manufacturer doesn't specify. Generally, cytosolic proteins require reducing conditions and membrane proteins like tetraspanins do not. Note that this is not a hard and fast rule and optimization is encouraged. After preparing your samples fully, it's time to get them loaded onto your gel. The choice of polyacrylamide percentage in your gel will be dictated by the size of the proteins that you're interested in studying. Smaller proteins require a higher percentage to resolve, and larger proteins require a lower percentage. If you'll be identifying proteins of a number of different sizes, then a gradient gel may be your best choice. After adding in the correct controls and loading your samples, you're ready to run your gel and transfer it over to a Western blot membrane. Usually these are made of cellulose or PVDF. After transferring, check to see that protein has indeed transferred to the membrane by using a reversible stain such as Ponso S solution. A ladder-like pattern of proteins should appear in each well with a loaded sample. If you are keeping the loaded volume of sample the same, then you should see different intensities of staining between different fractions. If your samples are not concentrated enough to see a signal, then you may need to concentrate your sample using the QEV magnetic concentration kit or the QEV concentration kit. The advantage of these kits over centrifugal concentrating filters is that they pellet your EVs, allowing you to resuspend your sample in just the right amount of lysis buffer needed to run your assay. If at this stage your proteins are only at the very top of the gel, then it is possible that lysis was not sufficiently harsh. If this is the case, you may want to increase your Reaper concentration. And if using a precast gel, you may want to check that you have removed any packaging strips at the bottom of the gel, which prevent the gel from running properly. After washing off your reversible membrane stain, the next step is to use antibodies to detect your protein of interest. This should be done using the protocol provided by the antibody manufacturer, as hopefully they have done some quality control testing. However, it is likely that this protocol will require some optimization in your hands to achieve the best signal. If you do not detect the protein of interest, then you can try concentrating your samples and trying again. If still absent, your EVs likely do not contain that marker. The literature shows that not all EV isolates are positive for all tetraspanins. CD63 appears to be particularly difficult to detect, and so CD9 or CD81 may be used instead. Finally, comes interpretation of your results. If they don't match your expectations, then it's always best to double check. In this case, it's best to run the blot again with new samples before you make any scientific interpretations, avoiding any potential misinterpretation. If your results are different with Gen 2 columns as compared to legacy columns, then it is possible that the protein now missing was actually a contaminant, as Gen 2 columns result in purer isolates than legacy columns were ever capable of producing. If, after following this guide, you're still having trouble with your EV Western blot, then you can get in touch with our support team, who will be happy to help you.